So we had the most recent Nintendo Direct happen, and there were some pretty cool points, but there was one part in particular that really, really surprised me. And I started to realize that people around me maybe were unsure as to why I was so excited, or they didn't really know what was going on. And that was the announcement for Jedi Outcast. This is one of my favorite games ever. Now, I will say, I think I like the first Jedi Knight more, but if you look at that, I don't think they would be able to sell it very well nowadays with the visuals, unless it gets a full remake. But again, Star Wars license, all that stuff, who knows how all that would even happen, or if there would be a company willing to put that kind of money in. But after seeing people's reaction to the visuals for Jedi Outcast, that game would have no chance nowadays, because Jedi Outcast visuals are dated, but they are like right at that cutoff where people can at least tolerate them to play it. Although I guess people do play the original Turok that kind of got a little bit of a remaster, so hey, maybe there is some room for that. But today I want to talk a little bit about Jedi Outcast and why I like it so much and why you should not sleep on it, because the Switch and the PS4, but the PS4 is going to get other Star Wars games, but the Switch in particular, which has only really had Star Wars Pinball, is about to get a very good Star Wars game, and you should not sleep on it. It's actually out on the 24th of September, so it's out in a couple of weeks. And yeah, I think that's one that everyone should take a look at. We still need to see the pricing. I don't think I've seen anything about that as of this recording, but if it's a fair price, it is worth a playthrough with the single player. I would say if it's like $20, it's worth picking up. And yes, this is my boxed copy on the PC. We could technically do an unboxing for a PC game of Jedi Outcast. While that might not be very exciting to some, it does come with something that looks like a CD. It's super weird to see that in a PC box nowadays. Generally, it should just be a code, right? Also, this is when manuals were, you know, more than like a pamphlet. This is a serious manual. This thing folds out. This thing has an actual fold out in the back. It's crazy stuff back then. Oh, I flipped it over and looked at the minimum system requirements. Needs 64 megabytes of RAM. Oh no, 128 megabytes of RAM, 64 megabytes is what's required, 128 is recommended, so I think we made the cutoff. Anyway, what is Jedi Outcast? Well, Jedi Outcast follows a character by the name of Kyle Katarn, who was the star of Dark Forces when it came out, right? So we had Dark Forces 1, which was basically a shooter. So consider back then, we were playing games Wolfenstein, Doom, we wanted our Star Wars shooter, we got it in Dark Forces, but back then, you need to have a lightsaber. Like, if you don't have a lightsaber in your game, there's an issue, especially if it's a Star Wars license. We like lightsabers, let's be real. So what did they do? Well, they took Kyle and they turned him into basically a Jedi. He all of a sudden was linked to the Force, and in Dark Forces 2 Jedi Knight, he became a Jedi. It was a pretty, I think, really cool experience. Back then, it was amazing. This was in 1997 that game came out, and I loved it. I got it for Christmas one year and just played that game like crazy. Then we had a game called Mysteries of the Sith, which was an expansion that released in 98. And then finally in 2003, so we went a while, 2003, we had Outcast come out. And Outcast, I remember getting on the PC, and then I also remember renting it at one point on the GameCube. And I played it like crazy on the PC, and I really liked it. But that was the continuation of Kyle Katarn's journey. Basically, after the events of Mysteries of the Sith, he pretty much turned in his lightsaber and walked away for what was a while, it was 8 years. 8 years after Jedi Knight ended, that he had to come back in Outcast and relearn the ways of the Force. Now, I'm not going to explain why he has to relearn the ways of the Force, because the game that's coming out on the Switch and the PlayStation 4 is only going to be the single player, it sounds like. Academy will follow next year, and that will have multiplayer, but the single player experience in Outcast is good. I like the story is actually interesting. There are some twists, some turns, some things you technically don't really see coming, and it was a really fun thing to follow through. But the one thing that got me when I would play this is they eventually bring in Luke Skywalker. He ends up being Kyle's mentor, essentially, and helps him relearn the ways of the Force and get his lightsaber back. And that's where things really take off. When you get your lightsaber, because early on in the beginning of the game, you go through a level or two without it, and you're like, okay, this is basically just an early shooter. But when you get that lightsaber, things really, really change. Seriously, if you pick this game up, stick with it until you get the lightsaber, and the whole game opens up. I mean, that's really what this game focused on. Sure, it was based on id Tech 3, which was used for things like Quake 3 Arena or Return of Castle Wolfenstein. Even the original Call of Duty used id Tech 3. But the thing that this game had was third-person combat with the lightsaber. And when you were using that lightsaber, you felt powerful. They had three different stances, which is something that I was even asking for the latest game, Jedi Fallen Order, to do, and I'm not really sure if they're to that point, but you had basically a fast, a medium, and a heavy. So you would do really strong attacks that were slower, and if you were able to time them right and dodge, you would get a pretty solid combo and be able to take out other Sith, essentially, that were fighting. And of course, the Stormtroopers would, you'd roll right through them without too much issue as you got further in the game. See, what happens in this game is as you play through further and further, you'll get more force powers, your force powers will get stronger, and Kyle will start to get stronger as he remembers everything that's going on, and he starts to become more, I guess they say, one with the force at that point, right? So he gets his force pushed to be stronger, where he's pushing multiple enemies, he can deflect rockets back, he gets the ability to trick people's minds, and what they'll do is they'll end up being on your side and shooting all of their allies on the other side. You can even trick them into opening doors for you to get through certain parts of the game. You get force lightning, force grip, you have the ability to force heal, you can jump super high using the force. There's a lot of stuff happening. The speed, force speed, is really cool because it'll slow down time, and then you can run through things or get a bunch of shots in on an enemy before they can even react. Basically, everything around you slows down and you go at normal speed. It was a really, really cool effect for the early 2000s. But my favorite part about this game is when you go up against another Jedi or another Sith, and they have a lightsaber, you have a lightsaber, and you're just clashing. It is so, so cool because the combat itself is free-flowing, as in it doesn't lock you into anything. So you'll see like events that take place in like some of the newer games where they're set pieces. So you hit a few times and all of a sudden the camera changes and you're locked into a certain thing, and it's kind of a cutscene, kind of not. But this is completely free-flowing, so you and the other person can do combos next to each other. You can kind of just wing it and just swing away with your sword and hope that it works. There are times where you'll clash and you'll get stuck and you'll try to overpower each other, but for the most part, this is straight-up free-for-all lightsaber combat, and it's one thing that a lot of us really like about this game, is you feel powerful, you can feel in control, or you can just go crazy with the lightsaber and hope it works. My favorite part about the PC version, which, by the way, if you just want to get this game now on Steam, you can. It'll run on like anything. Like, seriously, it doesn't need much at all to run. Any laptop or netbook or anything probably bought in the last 10 years will most likely play this game without too much issue. But my favorite part about the PC version that I don't think the Switch or PS4 version will have, which, hey, I could be wrong, maybe Aspyr goes crazy with it, were the cheat codes. You could do so much stuff. There were cheat codes to just drop into an X-Wing randomly. It could crash your game, but you could just drop into an X-Wing. You could give yourself all the force powers in the beginning of the game, all of the weapons. You could turn on God mode. You could turn on no clipping. You could do all kinds of stuff. There are hidden character models in the game you could just use. You could level skip. It was so much fun. Think about just starting in the beginning of the game with everything. Force powers, lightsabers, all this stuff. The enemies had no idea what hit them, and you would just, it was so easy. Shift, tilde, and then you would just type out whatever you wanted, and I loved doing it. Even after beating the game, it made it so much fun just to go through with all of that stuff. Again, probably only on the PC version you'd be able to do that, but you could technically try it out for yourselves now, or hey, maybe we'll be surprised. The main story is actually pretty long as well. It's 24 missions, and according to a couple different places, it's roughly 12 to 13 hours to beat it the first time through. I would say that's about right. There are several missions to go through. They're different locations. I mean, the idea is pretty much the same. You go through the different levels, you have different objectives that take place, whether you gotta unlock a door or you have to wipe out a bunch of enemies, but really it's all about when you get the force powers, you get the lightsaber, and you roll through. Now, there are some cool levels levels, like, for example, when you do get back your lightsaber, that's pretty early in the game, you have to go through a, like, a temple of trials. I remember that one, by the way, being on G4 TV back in the day. That was the thing that they would constantly show, is where you'd meet up with Luke Skywalker, who was in the game, and you would get your lightsaber back from him, and it would show the temples, the trials and stuff. It was a couple minutes, but it was such a neat thing to see on G4 at the time. So, yeah, it's a relatively longer single-player experience. Like I said, if they drop this thing for about $20, I think it's a steal at that point. I also want to point out that because the system requirements on this game are so low and it ran on the GameCube and the original Xbox, I would expect it to probably be a 60 frames per second experience on the Switch, obviously the PS4. So it'll be very, very smooth. If you have, again, loaded up on PC, you get hundreds of frames without any issue. I expect it to be a very smooth experience on either one of them, probably full 1080p, 720p resolution on the Switch for docked and handheld. And I hope it comes out well on the other side with the port, and I hope it does well on the Switch. Academy is going to follow. Academy is another good one, but I think I think Jedi Outcast story is better, but we'll have full multiplayer online, it sounds like, and this one supported up to 32 people. 32 people online back then in the early 2000s. Yes, we had Battlefield, but this had lightsabers. 32 people online with lightsabers. You could even unlock dual-sided lightsabers in this one, and in Academy, they already have them. So think about it that way. This will get you ready for Academy if you want to go online, right? So make sure you check out Outcast. It's out, like I said, a couple weeks. I think it's worth picking up. And I'm so happy to see this game show up somewhere outside of the original Xbox, the GameCube, or the PC, because it has been kind of lying dormant at this point. So it's exciting stuff. But let me know what you guys think. If you remember this game, if this is new to you, here's the thing, though. It's going to be a Star Wars game that has lightsabers, that's fun, and shouldn't have microtransactions. What more could we ask for nowadays?